Namaste, I'm Dr. Divya Sitlani. I'm basically a homeopath and also a diabetic educator. So we are having this series. It's in six parts. And today we'll get started with the first part of diabetic camp kind of a thing. Diabetic awareness, diabetes management, breaking the myths about diabetes, and we'll see how we can go about it. Hello friends, I'm Dr. Divya Sitlani. I'm a homeopath and a diabetic educator too. Today we are on part two of diabetes, understanding diabetes as well as managing diabetes, part two session. So we'll get started. So yesterday we spoke a lot about the pre-diabetes or the insulin resistance. So today we will be speaking understanding the structure of a basic pancreatic cell. So pancreatic cells are of three types, and first of all, do not have that impression that pancreas means only insulin. No, pancreas does a lot of other functions also. It secretes a lot of digestive enzymes and juices, you know. That's why the pancreas is placed very, very closely to the ending part of the stomach and the beginning part of your large intestine, because that is the place where all the digestion and absorption processes occur. That's why we need these pancreatic enzymes, and the pancreas is placed just there in near the beginning of your small intestine. So let us study the cells now. Moving forward, alpha cells secrete glucagon. Now glucagon is the hormone which is secreted by your body when the blood sugars are very low. That means when you are experiencing a hypoglycemic attack, that is your blood sugars are very low, the alpha cells are called upon to secrete glucagon, which will immediately get your blood sugars in balance, increase them to be balanced. Second cells are the beta cells. These beta cells secrete your insulin. Okay. Now, insulin is secreted in response to high blood sugars. Okay. Whenever your blood sugars are high, that is whenever you eat anything, whether a carb, a protein, a fat, just about anything, what happens? The pancreas are called upon to be secreting insulin to convert that into energy, which is again taken up into the cells for performing their proper functioning. Now the delta cells, you can be saying that this is the grandfather or the father of both the alpha as well as the beta cells. Why do I call it the grandfather or the father? Is because the delta cells secrete somatostatin, and somatostatin is the hormone which manages or controls or regulates glucagon as well as insulin. So they do not move an inch without the permission of the somatostatin. So somatostatin is much more higher than your glucagon as your alpha as well as your beta cells. And somatostatin is secreted by the delta cells, right? So now what is the normal metabolism? First of all, to understand something abnormal, you should be knowing what is normal. So insulin is the key to help the body to use the carbs or any kind of sugar, okay, we need. So insulin is called upon, and insulin is the key, okay. So your key will fit into your keyhole. So the key, insulin fits into the keyhole and opens up. That is the key which opens up the cells. And then the cells take up all the necessary energy for proper functioning. So we have a pair of salivary glands on either side of the mouth. Actually, the process of digestion commences when you see the food. We say, no, my mouth is salivating, my mouth is watering. The Maharashtrians say, tondat pani sutna. This is because it's not just a process in the mouth. We visualize, we look at it through all the senses. Even if we are, you know, smelling something nice, our mouth starts watering, right? So then there is an esophagus. This is when we don't have diabetes. So then there is an esophagus, which is again not at all involved in the process of digestion. It is just a tube or a conduit, which is just transporting the food from your mouth to the stomach. Pancreas, this is a stomach. This is the J-shaped organ. Okay, stomach is a J-shaped organ. It's like a leather bag, and it just holds your food. It does the process of mixing and churning. And then there is hydrochloric acid, which is secreted by the goblet cells in the stomach. which helps in the digestion of food. See, this is the pancreas, which is exactly at the ending part of your stomach, as well as the beginning of your small intestines. Now, this is the liver. The liver is known as the busiest port of your body. Why do I say that? What's a port? Is a place where all the ships are anchored. Liver is considered the busiest port of your body because there are a lot of activities going on in the liver. It manages the production of bile, and the extra bile is stored in the gallbladder so that in the day, you have something sweet. The bile is asked upon because bile emulsifies the fat, okay, helps in the digestion of fat. And liver also stores a lot of toxins. It is also the place where the synthesis of a lot of vitamins happen, also a place where a lot of mineral synthesis happens, and liver is really, really important. Then we have the large intestine, that's the ascending colon, transverse colon, and the descending colon of the large intestine. Small intestine is actually 26 feet long. I do not know why it's called the small intestine. It's really long and it's convoluted and placed in between the large intestine. And there we have a rectal ampulla where the stool is stored until the conditions are favorable for us to evacuate. And then we have the rectal orifice or the anus from where the stool is evacuated. Okay, so this is about your normal body. Now let us understand the two types of diabetes. So type one is infectious. It usually comes after you have severe infection, any kind of infection. The person may be lean. It's not necessary about that truncal obesity. And it is considered as an autoimmune disease. Autoimmune disease, very, very important. Autoimmune, that means your own cells are harming your own cells because they cannot identify, they cannot differentiate between your body cells and the alien cells. Okay. Now, here it's important again to understand that there is beta cell injury. Okay. So it can also be known as beta cell disruption. The beta cells are fired and they are no longer capable of secreting insulin. That's the reason you need to supply insulin from external sources. Okay. Age will be less than 40 years. You know, young children in, you know, teenagers, they're in school and suddenly they collapse, you know, and then you realize they are diabetic. Usually before 20 years, it's diagnosed. And there is certainly a genetic susceptibility towards diabetes part one. Let's understand type 2 diabetes. This is a disease, you know, as I always say, India was considered as a malnourished country. No, now there is malnourishment. What do? We visit malls and then we, after shopping, we need to have some grub. Okay. So it's considered as a overnutrition, overweight, you know, obesity. Overweight is a stage which is a little before obesity, before you're diagnosed obese, you are diagnosed as overweight. Okay. So there is overnutrition, and then there is sedentary lifestyle because we give the patent excuse of lack of time. And I always say, is it available on Amazon? Is it available in your Nandu store? Otherwise, there would be ladies queuing out there. So this is again an excuse, sedentary lifestyle. Family history, yes, there is. It is true, but then I feel that more than this, it is your, you know, there is something known as epigenetics, which is about genetics. Because if you study epigenetics, and which is higher than genetics, it believes that you may be carrying the genes of your disease. But for them to be manifesting or blooming, you need the appropriate conditions. If you do not give that disease, the cells, the genes, those appropriate conditions, the disease will not be allowed to manifest. Okay. Now, this is generally seen above 40 years of age, and there is a genetic susceptibility. There is peripheral insulin resistance, which we will take in detail. And then there is beta cell dysfunction, not disruption, dysfunction. They are not functioning. So initially, sometimes what happens, the doctor may be advising you to take an external insulin shot, but then that later on can also be weaned away, because as they say that if you insist, no, I, even though my diabetes is around 480, I don't want to commence with the insulin. No. Nobody likes to inject themselves every day. But then the thing is that you will be flogging a tired horse. Who's the tired horse? They are your pancreas. It's a tired horse. So do not think that once you have taken insulin, you will not be able to wean it or, you know, stop it completely. There is a lot of scope. You can come from the insulin shot to the tablets, and then you can even wean away those tablets if you are intending to reverse your disease. Okay, it has a lot of homework to be done by your family system, by your doctor, by yourself, but it can be done. Nothing to lose heart. Okay, because the beta cells are capable of producing insulin too. Now, there is one more type of diabetes which is known as gestational diabetes mellitus. Why gestational? Because this happens when the lady is pregnant. It is a matter of concern because there is a lot of, the baby will be born with a lot of weight, you know, heavyweight babies, and it's not a great idea. That's why ladies are always screened for diabetes mellitus during their pregnancy. And these ladies, once they have delivered the child, they will be off they will not be diagnosed as diabetics, but then they do stand a chance of developing diabetes maybe later on.
Help Talks are daily health related talks held at Health Education Library for People, Mumbai, India. For more information, visit www.healthlibrary.com. Subscribe to Help Talks channel. Be better informed about your health.